Now, we'll follow his exploits at this year's Burning Man Festival that faced some serious challenges. It will begin with Before the Rains Came. In the coming weeks, we'll have a third eye view of a playa turned to plaster. But now we'd like to welcome a great friend of all of ours. Everybody at the NSA loved him at the convention. Silverman. You're great. Oh, there you go.
Thanks,
got a spotlight side by side. Oh, you look great. We're both in costume. See, imagine us walking down the street together.
That's scary. Yeah.
We need to go to Times Square once. We'll have to pull that one off. There's no question about it. Anyway, we're going to get moving on this because I think this is, we got a lot to do because later on we're going to go visit a Maker Faire. But now we're going to get moving here. Let's see if I can share the screen and get this stuff all set up. Actually, I'll ask these questions as we're progressing because I think it's going to be a lot more fun. Nobody wants to hear me. This is so good. This is more important. So it's going to take a little bit because we had a computer stuff didn't work. Let's call it that. But now it seems to be happening.
Yeah, this is a shot of the man where you get to see some of the detail of the neon on him. And if you notice the base that he's standing on, the theme for Burning Man this year was Animalia, which basically means just animals. And so the theme they came up with for the base of the man was sort of this honeycomb structure. It was kind of interesting to be able to, this is about as close as you could get to the man this year, because you couldn't walk up on the platform that he was on. But it was interesting, the neon. One thing I should say before we get too much into this is, it was an unusual year, not just for me, but for everyone, because we had, for the first time, a sustained rain, which in the playa at Burning Man turns it into an insufferable mud. You cannot move, cars cannot drive, bicycles can't, you can't ride around on a bicycle. It's even difficult to walk. And so that drastically changed things. And that happened on Friday. And it also happens that on Friday, just as the rain started, I came down with COVID.
Oh, so
it was an interesting year for me. And part of the point of that is, in the second part, it sort of divided this into two parts. This is before the rain. And then next time we'll see what it's like at Burning Man with a lot of mud.
Yep. Hold on a second. For some reason, I'm not advancing. We're advancing. Oh, this is great. This guy made it back again.
Yeah, the man who made this didn't attend this year. Dwayne, he wasn't able to make it, but El Pupo Magnifico was there. And this is a rare shot where it's not shooting flames.
Wow. Why did he make it?
It's built on a truck chassis. And this is the second incarnation of this mutant vehicle. The first one was called El Pupo Mechanico. And it was made mostly out of stuff that was gotten from a junkyard, and a lot of it was made of steel and it was rusting. He took that and he sold it, took the money from that, and rebuilt it using aluminum for all the upper parts so it won't rust.
And the name, where does that come from? Is that
Spanish for the octopus?
Oh, the octopus.
The magnificent octopus.
Excellent. Now, why didn't he come this year?
He had some health issues.
That'll do it to you.
I don't know the name of this mutant vehicle, but it's kind of unusual to have a mutant vehicle in the shape of an outreached hand. And I thought it was good to get the fingers coming through the screen.
Yeah. Oh, it's excellent. These are you really massaged these. I took some good shots this year. I can't find, you usually don't have a bad one anyway, but I can't find one I don't like. Let's put it that way.
This art piece was called I Am Scrim. And about 10 years ago, on the internet, you could download these PDFs and print them out and fold them. And what made them interesting, it was an optical illusion. The face of this animal is going away from you instead of toward you. And of course, we humans expect faces to come toward us. And that's what made this interesting. So they built a life-size version of what was originally on paper. And I don't know if the optical illusion comes through in 3D, but the face is going away from you, not toward you. And if you're not paying attention, it's hard to tell, even in 3D.
How tall is that?
Oh, how tall? It's about 10 feet high.
Oh, 10 feet. Okay, makes sense. Because I was just trying to get some scale with what's around the thing.
This is Queen Cobra. Cobra, sorry. I can't speak today. Queen Cobra. One of the makers of this is Andy Tibbetts, who often, typically, camps with Claire Dean. And this artwork, as you can tell, is something that is meant to be climbed on. And so that person doing a handstand is making good use of the art.
Well, I just noticed that now when you said it. That's one thing about a reptilian face like that. You know, it's built into your DNA to not move your eyes a little bit.
This is a Mariposa by my friend Christopher Chart. And he's done a number of these LED art pieces, and he programs the display on the LEDs to in time with music. And it's really interesting to see dozens of people under this butterfly whose wings are moving up and down, and patterns and images on the LEDs that correspond to the music, like something like Dark Side of the Moon.
That's excellent. And now how long before the rain was this? Because I missed that. When did the rain show up?
Oh, the rain started Friday afternoon, late Friday afternoon.
And these were taken at what time? When?
Well, this one was taken near dawn on Wednesday morning, I think.
Wow.
And this piece is called Complexahedron.
And now these are both part of the same exhibit. The thing, the sculpture on the right is associated with the one to the left.
Yeah, they were part of the same piece. Although I don't really know the connection of the sculpture to the other part of the piece. The geometric shape is meant to represent one of the earliest multi-celled life forms.
Is there a reason you shot it from this direction? Is that how you like approach it? When you're looking at the artwork?
No, well, I wanted to incorporate the sculpture and, you know, get some depth between the sculpture and the geometric life form shape in the back.
So there's nothing on the other side of the geometric form?
No.
Yeah, what you said. Okay, gotcha.
This piece has a rather odd name, hashtag VAGR. But it was about a 30-foot high inflated pink tiger. To me, it looks like a cat, but because of the stripes, it's a tiger.
I guess they had a motor keeping that thing full, right? Because I see something generator, something.
Yeah, a generator pumping air into it.
Pumping air, keeping air going, yeah.
This piece is called All in Your Head. And at night, they projected different patterns on it, but I never saw it at night, but it was an interesting piece.
Are the pieces to the sections of the skull? Okay, they are. I was going to say, are they flat? They look like they've got dimension, the one to the right and the left. They actually look even though I know it's not, they actually look like they have more depth. But they're only cutouts, right? Like the one in front of us.
Yeah, they're flat planes.
Well, that's a great illusion. This even 3D, it still feels to me that there's more depth on the faces to the left and the right. It's interesting how a brain works.
This piece is called Respirator, and as I understand it, when there's a breeze or wind, it would, the inner part that you can't really see here would respond and sort of breathe. But I happened by it when there was no breeze at all. But it was, what was interesting is the light coming through this translucent plastic material that they use. I thought that made for a good photograph. And in the background, you see two robots. And there's a story behind those robots that you'll see, and I'll explain in the next photo. They had a battle. It's called Mechan 1 and Mechan 1000. So Mechan 1 is supposed to be this sort of early prototype of a robot that was made out of wood. And Mecha 1000 is the robot made out of metal. And they're going to have a battle. You see, the one with wood is armed with a wrench. Ah. And the one that's metal is armed with an axe. And they battled it out on Thursday night. And in the next photo,
they battled it out, huh? Uh-oh.
Guess who won? Yeah, you can see the wrench there, and the wood robot, of course, was defeated and burned.
Russ never sleeps. He just should be a wise guy back there thinking he aluminum. Holy, they got it all figured out. Wow, that is great. I could see the wrench. It's so great. Now, how did that? Okay, so wait a minute. Was this an epic battle, or just knock that guy over and send him? Were you there for the whole round?
I didn't see the battle. The statues didn't act. They were not actual robots. You know, they didn't move. And I got there after it had already burned, so I just was able to get this photo of the wooden robot was still burning.
Okay. Yes, I figured they weren't motorized. I had a vision of people shoving them into each other. I just love that. I'm going to leave that in my brain and let it keep going. There we go.
Yeah. I don't know the name of this art piece, but what I like about this shot is that the art piece in the background that's framed nicely by the arch.
Now that all that to the left, that little, all that light out there, is that like with the is that where most of the art is, or is that an exhibit, or what? Why, you see what I mean? All the way to the left, or
to the left?
Yeah. If you go down on the ground, it looks like there's almost a city in the distance. Maybe I'm just seeing it incorrectly.
Oh, okay. Well, right at the very edge.
Yep.
That's the temple of heart.
Oh, I guess we'll get over there.
This art piece was called Nazar, and it was basically meant to be an eyeball. And I thought this was a good time to take a photo. The sun just having, just after sunrise coming through the back of it. Thought that worked all right.
Sunrise coming through. Interesting. So is there a specific, I wonder if there was a specific position you placed that in, right? To get the sun in that direction, right? Or have the eye facing in a certain way. Because that is, it's rising behind it, right? So,
yeah, I think it's just coincidence.
Coming up in the east,
the sun was coming up behind it.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, when they have these locations, are they like told go to spot number whatever to install their art piece?
Yeah, there's specific spots, and they're marked on the ground with a disc with some red strands coming up from it, and that's the spot where there's. They need to install their art piece.
Ever have anybody take somebody's parking spot? Maybe the two robots would resolve
that. I haven't heard of anyone, encroaching on someone else's designated art, positioning, but I'm sure that's happened.
I guess there'd be no reason. There's a lot of room out there, but anyway.
Yeah,
someone could make a mistake is what I'm getting at, that's right.
Yeah, well, the curators take a lot of time and thought and positioning these things for maximum, maximum enjoyment.
So what do you? So you can kind of get some scale by the stuff that's tacked to it. Is that an explanation of the artwork? Is that what is the stuff on the legs or the?
Okay. Well, this is called the Hedgehog Temple, and it's a tribute to the Ukrainian resistance, especially those people that are trying to stop the Russian tanks. And so these things that you see on the legs of the hedgehog are photos of soldiers that are fighting on the side of Ukraine, and that cross of sticks under the hedgehog is something that's used to stop tanks.
And I guess this is, it does appear to be wood, right?
Yeah, that's made out of wood. I think the ones that are used to stop tanks are made out of steel, I would suspect.
Oh, I'm just saying that the lay, so
yeah, now, the whole thing is wood. And I think
the whole thing is wood. And do you have an idea what they use? What material? It's not canvas, something obviously you can see through it, so it's sheer enough.
Probably camouflage netting, that would be my guess.
Interesting. Now, the last thing is, there's like a little, are there lights on the tips of those things, or is that just the sun catching them?
Yeah, those are lights, and at night they were rather bright.
Oh, any light in the head?
Yeah.
And
Yes. This piece is called Yuluka, and it's from Colombia, and there's a Colombian sort of mythology of a double-headed creature of some sort, and that's what this is representing.
Could you climb into it? Is that where that gaping thing is? Or, oh, I thought there was a hole. It's solid, sorry. For a moment, I thought that was a compartment underneath the neck. Mm-hmm.
I don't know the name of this piece, but it was made up of multiple pyramid structures, and I thought the shadows coming through were effective. So,
and Silverman, as you're presenting these, right? Would this be a sequence that you would have wandered into, or you just picked them? Because, you know, simple question: would you encounter these on a stroll, or you just put the images as you pleased? Which is either one is fine.
Well, you can probably tell for many years I've had a tradition of at least one day of the week getting up before dawn to get shots at around sunrise for two reasons. One, the nice lighting that you get, but also it's about the only time when you can get photos of a lot of the art without a dozen people in front of you.
Yeah, thank you. Just one last question. To the like the lower left of the pyramid, is this some? Is that a person or a thing? What is that? Do you have an idea?
I think that's a bicycle.
Wow.
And that's kind of typical. I wish that burners would be more sensitive about keeping their bicycles and other things away from the art, but.
He pulls it. It's like the serious. This is like a kickstand. Anyway, that's clear. You're right. Then. Oh, this is great. Again,
this is Black Rock Station. They built a train station in the middle of the desert.
Now, does this gets in a thing like this would be installed and taken apart every year, right? Or no?
Yeah, this has been out there before. So they take it apart and they store it and then they brought it back.
Oh, there's a bicycle again. Another bicycle leaning against it.
There's a bicycle leaning on the art over there, and there's one just there in the middle of the shot. Sometimes I will move bicycles out. Not always. Now, this was interesting. I think these folks may have been part of the artists who created this. There was a professional photographer, which you could tell because he had a big digital SLR, but he was taking their photos, and obviously it was somewhat staged, and I was curious as to why there was one of them was playing the accordion, but you never know.
It you got the shadow, so did it. It's great, the shadow of the signals, right, are on the side. It's great. The whole thing is so composed so well, man.
Yeah, we just get rid of all those bicycles that are in the way over there. Now, this is a serendipitous shot because you've got the parts of the train station, and you've got this old farmhouse over there. Well, the farmhouse is not part of the train installation. It's actually a mutant vehicle that just happened to be parked there.
Interesting. So the people, like, it kind of begs the other question. You have your own site. So you don't think that they figured, no, they highly likely they would have just figured, hey, this would make a cool looking, if we put the farm there and the thing, that wouldn't happen. It would just randomly happen, you think?
Yeah.
Excellent.
This is called the Ursas. You have the two bears, Ursa Major and Ursa Minor. The smaller of the bears was at Burning Man last year. And this year they brought the smaller bear and the larger one. And you can get a sense of the scale here because you can see the people. But inside the larger bear, the inside was tiled with infinity mirror material, which made it very trippy. And people enjoyed that. And this is another angle. This is, I wanted to make sure to have a few photos in here that are not on the website. This is one that's not on the website, but it's just a different angle on the two bears. But also you notice they're a different color because they kind of cycled through colors. Every couple of minutes, they would be a different color.
Oh, that must be beautiful to behold, right? And what is it, like plexi or something they've got, or some opaque material there? Well,
on the bear that's closer to you, you can see the infinity mirror effect.
Ah.
So you would get this pseudo depth in the panels of the bears.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, yep.
Now this piece was Time Camp Clock Brothers. And this is another photo that's not on the website. I wasn't sure it was interesting enough, but what it is this was an interactive piece. You could go up there and change what this digital display said. You could change it to any numbers or letters, just as you would in a digital clock. And of course, every adolescent boy knows what this is. 8008 is boob, right?
Oh, look at that. Well, thank you. Apparently, I missed that in my adolescence, but
I was
stuck around long enough to learn.
Well, my adolescence was before digital clocks, but
I got it. Now I can't help but see it. You keep abreast of the situation with this one. Now, what is that thing in the thing in the front of the box?
Yeah,
what is that, the thing that controls the lights if you went over and played
with
it?
Yeah. Yeah, so you could go up there and change what it said.
Wow. Now I can't help but see boob on it. Thank you for that.
This is called The Journey Aquatic. And it's about 15 feet high to the top of that turtle. And it looked very different at night because it was internally lit and shadows would come out. As you can see, sort of the cracks in the shell, light would come out from that. Yeah.
And the material, is that aluminum also, or what is that?
I don't know.
Okay, fair answer.
I don't know if it was steel or aluminum. I didn't check it that closely.
It's another great shot. I just like staring at it.
This is one of my favorite pieces from this year. The same artist last year had a similar statue, but it was just a woman's head, and that was called Seed of Dreams. This sculpture is called Touch the Sky, and it's by Martin Taylor and the Chromaforms. And what it's made out of is laser cut stainless steel.
How is it getting lit, Silverman?
Well, inside they have this gold colored intense LEDs, I suspect.
Now I'm understanding it. So got it.
Yeah. And interesting thing about this particular shot is it's kind of symmetrical. You've got the man pavilion on the left, and on the right, you have El Pupo Magnifico shooting off some propane.
it's phenomenal to look at and extraordinarily hard to capture. It's just incredible because of the contrast and the light that you got that much detail in this. Man, it's gorgeous.
This was a very impressive piece. It was called Chapel of Babel. And it was somewhat controversial to people. This artist has done a number of things. I mentioned before the show that in 2015, Susan Sarandon brought some of Timothy Leary's ashes to be burned in another piece by this same artist. And what made this controversial is, if you notice right in the middle, that figure above the door wearing the hat, that's Larry Harvey. And some people didn't like this because they thought it was sort of idolizing the members of the Burning Man organization, because inside there are lots of photographs of the Burning Man organization, Maid Marian and Larry Harvey and the others.
Yeah, yeah. Who's the guy peeking out the door down below there? The noggin, the big noggin. Is that supposed to be one of those people? Was it?
I'm not sure who that is.
Okay. But you went into this thing, did you not?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was very elaborate inside, which you'll see in the next photo.
And gotcha. So the head, is that like...
That's a photograph.
That was your answer, Michael. Yeah. Thank you.
That's a flat photo. And inside, all the surfaces were covered with these textured materials, as you can see, and photographs, mostly black and white photographs. This is another image that's not on the web page because, I wanted to have some unique photos for this presentation on the show today. But yeah, that gives you a sense of the detail in the interior.
Excellent. Is this the same structure?
Yeah, same structure, looking straight up. This is during the day and light is coming in through the top, and there's sort of a stained glass effect up there. And
this is all wood, this thing?
Wood and mostly paper.
And paper.
Because you have printed photographs on paper, on wood.
Oh, just one quick. When you walk in, let me just go back one. Okay, so is this the feeling you get when you walk in? Is that arch? Where is that arch when you, when you come in and look the piece of artwork there?
My memory is that arch is pretty much in the center. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and outside there's sort of a walkway around the outside of the structure and all of it is covered in photographs. Now this is maybe my favorite photo from this year. So I just was walking around in the afternoon and came upon this woman painting on a canvas and painting the Burning Man. And I asked her if I could take a photo. And I just thought it was really great to get the artist and what she's painting and the object in the same photo.
Yeah, yeah. I use this one on the email because I liked it. Yeah, she's got the whole head covering. Who knows what a religion is, but it or where she comes from, but it doesn't matter because it just has a wonder to it.
Well, that's practical headwear in the desert, so yeah, so you got to wear something.
Yeah, that's right. Listen,
I've had this tradition of getting up before dawn to go out and shoot, and it's become a tradition of being at the temple at sunrise. So I have gotten photos. This is the photo just after sunrise, sunlight coming through the intricate structure of this year's temple, which is the Temple of Heart. And in part two, you'll see the burning of the Temple of Heart, because that happened after the rain.
Now, what when you go, like you say, certain days you'll get up. Your process, you look at it. Do you look at everything and then come back with the camera, like study some angles, then come back with the camera?
That would be a great idea, but it's just not possible. There were over 400 registered art pieces, and I have 150 photos in this year's gallery. And some of the art pieces, I have 5 or 6 photos of them. This photo, of course, is just the man, and you see the honeycomb concept behind the pavilion that he was placed on top of. But no, I don't really have time to go out and preview all the art. There's just not enough time.
So do you stumble on these out of convenience, or you just look at the horizon and are drawn to those locations?
You know, the way that things are structured, you have this almost a circular city. In the middle is the Burning Man. In a straight line beyond that is the temple. So you're kind of drawn to those lines, you know. Huh. And so you go out, shoot the man, and then shoot the temple, and then work your way to the left or right to get other art. And then we're back to the neon, the detail of the neon, which is pretty good to get. It had to get that just a little bit after sunset to get that shot.
Like always, please go ahead. Okay. Got it. So we kind of did the circle. Thank you. Thank you, Dorothy. Okay, let me see if I can work this computer now. And I'll put my camera back on. It's a little tricky to work with your finger. Oh, there we go.
I went through pretty fast.
That was really incredible. Thank you for taking us on that journey again. I can't get enough of your work. I don't want to rush you. I don't want you to tear up, but really your work is so great, man. And you know it, and you got to know it because it's really amazing. I could look at those pictures for so long and just see more and more detail. Getting back to your process now. So you're basically drawn to those. I know you just explained how it's laid up, but there's got to be something that's making you, I'll take a left, I'll go this way, I'll go that way, there's something over here. Well, last year, maybe comparing something from the previous year, or I'll let you answer now because I asked the question and I answered it myself.
Oh, well, I'll tell you about cameras I used. This year I used my Canon G1X rig, which is getting kind of old, and I'm going to retire it and come up with a different rig. So I took quite a few photos. Most of the ones that were taken at dawn were taken with the Canon G1X rig. But just as many photos, maybe more, were taken with the Sony RX0. And I had a complication. One of the remote Sony multiport cables failed, but luckily Joseph Pearl had among his multiple camera utilities a Canon remote, I'm not Canon, sorry, Sony remote system, and I was able to use that. Walking around using the remote to take photos with my Sony RX0s. So thanks to Joseph.
Since you have so many cameras, what makes you determine which one? You don't carry them all with you when you're going out, do you?
No, that would be a bit much. Something I did this year, and I'm not sure it was a good idea. I would go out and I would decide on which rig I was going to use. I also had Canon T5 SLRs. Of course, the stereo base on those is a minimum of 6 inches. So those are always for somewhat hyper shots. So I would go out with those sometimes, the Canon G1X or the Sony RX0s. And I'd also carry a backup camera. And a camera that I used this year was the Lenovo Mirage. And I thought that was really convenient because, you know, the Mirage is so small and easy to carry. I thought, okay, for a backup camera, I'll carry this around. So I took a lot of the VR180 shots with this. So I would stop, take a photo with the G1X rig, and then pull this out and take a photo in the VR180. But then I was checking the photos when I got back, and the image quality on the Lenovo Mirage is just so bad. When you put on your Quest 2 or whatever and view it in VR, the resolution is so low that, you know, I'm not even sure it's, you know, it was a good waste, you know, a good use of time to even do that.
Glad you said that, because I had one of those. I sent it back for the same reason. I thought, oh man, you managed to make that thing work, you know.
It works, but yeah, the image quality just isn't there. It's not good enough.
So, you know, I'm just interested in your process. So it you got to have the same problem we all have. You get to a location, you go, damn, I wish I had the other camera with me. Yeah. So is that part of, you'll go back and grab another one or shoot one and kind of, because I know you have a lot of ground to cover. You know, it's like you can't keep going back and forth. Otherwise, you'll miss it. It's like going to the fair and only going to one thing. You know, I know you want to spend your time.
Well, it's very large and it's miles. It's like, it's maybe 2 miles between my camp and the man, for example. And even if I'm riding a bike, that takes time. And you've got to decide before you go what cameras you're going to take.
Now, do they shoot video, that your cameras?
Yeah, all of these will shoot video. The only thing that I shot video with this year was the Lenovo Mirage.
And that wasn't worth the using, I guess.
And, you know, I might try to edit it into something viewable, but, you know, again, the image quality, when you get that inside a VR viewer, it's kind of disappointing.
How do you get around? I mean, we discussed it before to some degree, right? They have some kind of booklet to show you where things are, right? They intended to be. You know, in other words, we said before, where you know that thing is going to be here because you have your little marker for your exhibit. So does that reference back to a map or something so you can get around? Yeah, okay. I answered the question for you.
Yeah, you did. But that map is so complicated and there are so many art pieces that I think few people actually use the map.
You know what they did? They turned the map into an art piece. It's not really a map at this point. It's an art piece. You'll just turn it upside down. Well, I guess you could use it in a ring. But wow, that is, I guess that's the spirit, right? You just explore. Is that really the fundamental?
Yeah, and things just happen. You know, it's... You never know what's going to happen. Something that I do is and kind of struggle with is some art pieces you will see during the day and you won't be impressed at all. It's like, well, what is that? Why did they even bother? Then you come by at night and it just blows your mind because it's it's something like Christopher Shard's butterfly. Mariposa was nothing during the day, but at night.
Yeah, I could see that because it probably looks pretty lame during the day. But my God, even the image that you showed without it moving is I can imagine how that looks. That's amazing.
Yeah, and something I sometimes do is get a shot of the same thing day and night and put those together. Yeah,
So you do, okay, got it. So you do kind of make a note of what you want. Right. Now, where is all your stuff at this point? And just one sec, Jay, just let me know if those guys manage to get when they show up on the Maker Faire thing. So your stuff, where do you keep it?
What do you mean? The cameras?
Your cameras?
Everything is in my car.
In the car.
I live in my car for the whole week. Yeah.
And now where are you sleeping and stuff?
Yes, I sleep in the car.
Yeah. I sleep in the car. Make it simple.
In a Prius, so that's...
Yeah, well, there you go. Yeah. Now, post Burning Man. Forget about the weather. How'd the cameras make out?
Well, pretty good, but
especially
like
the dust and the stuff. I know you always have trouble afterward. Like, yeah.
Yeah, I'm retiring after 9 years. The Canon G1X system. It's too many problems, and just, you know, they're getting old.
Yeah, it is problematic when the equipment starts giving you trouble, and you want that shot. Very frustrating. What happens then? It goes into the Burning Man. You make up an artwork out of it. It needs to be a piece of art. I'm sorry. I'm leaning too far back. Maybe you can't hear me well. Now, how many cameras did you take, actually? How many cameras did you have with you?
Oh, wow. Too many. I think I counted 16. I mean, I took, for example, my...
Is that 16 times two? Or 16 rigs?
Total. Well, not 15 rigs, but just total cameras. But for example, I took my Sputnik medium format, shot one roll, still haven't processed it because I've discovered it's hard to find some place to process a 120 slide film these days. But
Do you ever use Duane's in Kansas? I don't know if they're still doing stuff. They're the guys that got they were the last guys to do Kodachrome. They seen, I know that, I think they're still doing film and stuff. Dwayne's photo in Kansas. I'll send you the link to that. I'm sure it's still, I hope it's still around. One would only hope.
Yeah, that's one of two places I found online that will still process 120 slide film now.
Yeah, I wonder what they did. Imagine what could they have done with the Kodachrome machine? You know, I hate to think it ended up in a landfill. But anyway, so be it. That would make a nice art piece by itself, too. Man, those are great. I want to hear about, you know, how it got. I guess you've got enough photographs of that. How long did it take you to get off the site after the whole situation occurred there?
Well, we should probably get into those details in part two.
We'll go over that. We'll go there. Let's leave them. Yeah, let's leave them next week. Right at the end of the bridge with the train coming. I had some ideas with that. I mean, that would be the perfect place. You know, the one with the train stop. That's where you'd set up your sleeping bag right on the rail. I mean, that's where I would have slept.
Now that you mentioned that, I kind of regret I didn't get out to that when it was muddy. But, you know, it's so many things.
Yeah, it was only, you know, we're all so grateful that you endure the good and the bad. And bring out these wonderful images that allow us all to not get sand in our shoes. Or mud, for that matter.
It's playa dust. Playa dust. No sand, but...
Playa dust.
You
didn't like my little play on words there, playa plaster?
Hmm?
My little playa plaster?
Yeah. Oh, plaster, yeah. Well, you know, it became mud.
Yeah. Now, I had ridden along the way, I rode my motorcycle into a mud patch like that, but if it didn't have reverse on it, that big 850-pound thing, I would have never got it. It sank in right to the... But it looked fine, but man, it's like that fine stuff that was just alongside Route 66 that was left there forever. So I know what that can be. It was incredible. It's like stuck on everything, and it was the finest stuff, but it was mud. When I looked at those pictures, I knew just what they went through, man, because I had mud up to my top of my boots while trying to push the damn thing out. But anyway.
Yeah.
Thank you once again. How are we doing with the live? Because I'll stick with Silverman. I'm having fun.
You should have Joseph Pearl on to show some of his work. He has a very nice camera rig, and he prefers shooting people, and I prefer shooting objects.
Yeah,
so we're an interesting balance there.
Oh, that's where, and he's all he was also at the at the.
Oh yeah. Yeah, and then he took lots of photos.
We got to get him in. Yeah, yeah, that'd be great. Some people too is dying.
Yeah.
Help me. Oh, good. Listen, we'll corral you. Oh, hello there. Yeah, now we got you. We even have a picture of you wanted. Yeah, that's excellent, man. That you guys go through that is amazing to me.
Can I just mention one highlight was?
Please do.
Because Harold mentioned needing a part for his Sony, and he knew where I was camped, and he remembered I shot Sony, and he came walking up, and I saw him from a distance, and I said, "Well, hold on, Harold, don't come too close. I've got COVID," and he said, "I got COVID too." So we got to hang out. One of the few people I could stay close to.
That magnetic attraction to Silva Man. That's great. Mm-hmm. Oh, man. Yeah. You had some company. You rustled up some company. That's it. Well, thank you very much. Thank you both. And I certainly would like to, we're gonna track you down. Well, we already have, Silver Man will know your information. If you don't mind, that would be phenomenal. I so look forward to that.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you both again for, I can't wait to chat with you more, Pete. That's incredible. But now we're gonna go from the wonders of Silver Man to theoretically a live remote out of wherever that place is. Maker Faire with folks at Golden Gate Stereoscopic Society. Well, you know, who cares? The folks from Golden Gate, we're going to give a great try. They're going to take us through a Maker Faire. So can we cut over? And thank you, Joe. And thank you, Silverman, again. Oh, my God.
Thank you.
I applaud you, and I appreciate all your work and all your soberness. Can we give it a try? Matt, how we doing?
Hello, guys.
Yeah, okay, let's take my spotlight off. We can remove my spotlight. Okay, Joe. Go ahead, say something again there. Oh, there you go.
Hi, guys. Can you hear me?
Yep, just talk slower. Talk in braille.
Let's see, am I muted? Can you hear me? Great. Okay. Yes, you can see me too. Thank you for having us. This is a fantastic event, very well attended. So I think when I do my walkthrough, you're probably not going to be able to hear me. You'll just hear the din of the crowd. And that's a good problem to have. So before I do this walkthrough, I thought I'd just explain who we are for those who don't know us and what we're doing here at Bay Area Maker Faire 2023. We are the Golden Gate Stereoscopic Society. We're a camera club in the East Bay, San Francisco Bay Area. And we've been around in one form or another really since the 1930s. In our current form as the Golden Gate Stereoscopic Society, maybe 10 years or so. And we have about 10 or 12 active members. I'm sure you've seen their stereo photography before because most of us are active in international exhibitions, that sort of thing. And we do meet twice a month on Zoom, the first and second Tuesday of each month, where we show our stereo photos and talk about them. We'll talk your ear off about them. And if you're interested, we hope you drop by. These meetings are at 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Pacific time. That's going to be 10 to 12 East Coast time. I know that's a little late, but we'd still love to have you. We are here at Maker Faire. This is not our first Maker Faire, and we are showing off our photography and trying to get other people inspired to make their own stereo photography and maybe even join the GGSS. We have our 3D TV set up running a slideshow of about 200 of our favorite images from the past 18 months. And because of Jay Kusnet's efforts, we're also demonstrating three Loom Pad 2s. Those are the auto stereo tablets, and they are astonishing. We're getting an incredible turnout at our table. I think there's just something about 3D on a big screen that people can't resist. And kids especially are just blown away. So that's very encouraging for us. And what I would like to do now is take you on a tour. I'm gonna show you sort of the general crowd here at Maker Faire. I'm going to go, that's where the noise is. I'm gonna show you some of the other exhibits. We will go to our table so you can see what we are doing. And then I will join you back out here where it's a little bit quiet. So unless there are any questions or comments, I'll switch the camera over and let's do a little walkthrough. Okay, I'll do this as carefully as I can. Here I am outside. We are at Mare Island in Vallejo, California. It's the first time it's been held here. In the past, it was held in the South Bay at San Mateo. And this is a much nicer venue, much more open. We've got fantastic weather here. As you can see, we're right on the water. This is a formal naval base. And it's just a great day to be out. This is also a fantastic event for shooting stereo. If you're looking for a place to take pictures, there's so much going on here, so many people, and everyone is distracted, so you can get lots of people shots. You can see there are a lot of art installations here. Some of these you might be familiar with from Burning Man or other festivals. I'm not going to walk all the way over there, but you get the idea. We've got some antique machines. We've got some cosplayers.
When you're moving the camera, hold for a minute, right? You don't have to track anything because the bandwidth is, it's kind of, yeah, perfect. It's like Dramamine. That's, yeah. Excellent. Yeah, just like, yeah, perfect. Thank you, Matt.
All right, I'm going in. Let's see.
Hey Matt, once you get in there, anybody, you know, put somebody on the spot who's by your table and interview them about 3D. If possible. Yeah, a few audio issues on this side. I hope I sound a little more clear. Thank you. Thank you for mentioning that to me out there. Test one, two. Yeah, sorry about that, boys and girls. I was screwed that up. Oh, here we go. Excellent. What type of TV are they? What type of TV is that, Matt? It's got to be noisy in there.
introduce those folks, Matt. Hello there. I'm the size of a postage stamp. There we go. Look at, very nice. I want to move in. But you know you're muted, Matt, because it's probably very loud in there. Oh, look at that. I don't know what you're holding up there, Matt, but it doesn't look healthy. There we are. Look at you wowing the crowd. That is excellent. That is excellent. Hey, you know, Matt, I guess it's very hard to hear in there. As I could imagine, it's a big cavernous thing. But if you could find somebody to interview me, even your guys over at your desk there, or find the cool something that you think is cool, and let's ask those people about it, and give us the feeling like we're wandering around. We just wandered on off the playa. You know what, Matt, if you could get us in. Good. Very good. Standing by the standby. Oh, there you go. Now there you go, Matt. Unmute yourself. We can see you, but we can't hear you yet. But we will. Oh, man.
Can you hear me now?
Hear you perfectly.
Perfect. Yes. You probably couldn't hear me in there. It is extremely. But that's okay. We're showing still photos. One thing I wanted to point out: we are giving away these 3D pop-up cards. Let me switch the camera back over. These are Oh Wow cards. These were invented and printed by our legacy member, Jim Gasparini. These are meant to be mailed. We're using them as flyers. We have some GGSS club information on the back. And these pop into little cardboard stereoscopes. Now, these have just been flying off the table. People love them. And these are, this is the last batch of his stock. So after this, they'll be gone forever. But it's a great way to distribute information about our organization. Now, I just showed you a little bit of it. Was there anything anyone wanted me to go back over again?
I realize it's so loud in there that it's probably hard to. Well, are there any outside things where there are people near that, you know, that maybe we can get up to and embarrass them or embarrass ourselves?
let me see what I can find. Let me walk over here.
Perfect. Thank you. What is that thing over there? Get closer to the cell tower.
am I breaking up?
No, it's okay. You're okay. It's you're all right. You're fine.
I think I'm out of the Wi-Fi range.
Yeah, you're just starting to break out.
Closer.
Yes.
This might be a little better. let's go see what's over here.
Oh, Harold mentioned it, that that was from Burning Man last year, that horse.
I think there are some other artworks that have been that are from Burning Man also. And of course, Harold is the expert.
Ah, indeed. Well, so far, I can kind of monitor your signal. Looks like you got several bars.
Quite sure this is a Maker Faire piece. I have not seen that, Harold. Unfortunately, I've been mostly stuck at the table. We've been so popular, we really haven't had a chance to explore.
That's like a mermaid.
Precisely.
Let's see if we can get somebody to chat with. Although we love you, Matt. Let's see if we interrupt somebody around here.
Hi there, having fun? All right. Hi there. Yes.
Hey, hello. Yes. Hello from New York. How are you doing? You enjoying yourself?
I'm live streaming this to New York at a 3D club. Yes.
New York 3D club.
Whoops. Hey, that's for you. That's a 3D card. Yes. It pops into a little cardboard 3D viewer. So enjoy.
Yeah, enjoy. Yes. Hey, what did you like? What have you seen anything you like? Ask somebody what's the best thing they like. And then we'll go over to that and torture those people.
You got it. Let's see. Hi there. Would you mind telling us, I'm live streaming this to New York. Would you mind telling us what your favorite exhibition is here? The cupcake. There is a motorized cupcake around here. I haven't seen her since yesterday, but we'll keep my eyes open.
That's pretty great, too.
All right. Thank you very much.
Well, yeah, thank you. Have a wonderful day there.
So I'm
heading to catering at this point for sure. This is nice. Yeah, cupcake sounds like a perfect breakfast. Cupcake? Yeah, we need the cupcake.
It's not a cupcake you eat. It's a cupcake you drive, literally. She's here somewhere. I've seen her around.
Yeah, the rolling cupcake.
But I think I might be getting out of Wi-Fi range here.
Yeah, I think you're a little tough. Now, this is on an island, right? How do people get here? Is it a bridge or a boat, or how do you do that?
Oh, there is a bridge. There's also a ferry that'll get you here. It's pretty accessible. I can't say I've spent a lot of time in this part of town before, but it's really nice.
Man, beautiful.
Let's see.
Yeah, we need something. These have all been very interesting, but I see what your point is. Inside, it might have been loud because we didn't hear if he was talking at all. We really didn't hear anything. But I think you were on mute at that point. Let's see what we got. Well, thank you for taking us through this crowd.
Well, you're very welcome. It's been a pleasure. And I would like to thank Jay again for setting up the loom pads that we're demonstrating. They are very popular. They're really remarkable devices. It is pretty chaotic here. Next year, I'll bring... I'll bring a book and a headset so that I can hear and I can hear you and you can hear me doing this little tour.
You were great. You were up to the challenge. I see you're up to the challenge, you know, because this was not simple. At this point, I feel like I've been on a combination of a ship in rough seas and a roller coaster. But you did such a great job. No, really. Thank you. This is just so wonderful to take a peek, man. You know, we got to get you guys on our show a little bit. Maybe.
We would love it. We've got lots of stuff to show, lots of stuff to talk about. So just name a date.
That's it. Well, it'll be Golden Gate Stereoscopic
Golden
Society
Gate
Day.
Stereoscopic
yeah, man.
Society.
Date. And we'll bring you in. We'll do like a 15, 20 minutes of whatever or more. You and your compadres there have been so generous. I want to thank you. We're going to go. Oh, wait a second. Yeah. Somebody did mention, do you have a Steadicam? But, you know, I like it better this way because this way I'm rocking back. No, that was phenomenal. The job you did was great. impromptu, and we made it work. That's the amazing part.
Made it work.
Matt, you were great. Yes. Open invitation. Thank you, and thank everybody at the desk and at your conta there, and wish them our regards. Thank you very much. Oh, nice. We'll leave with the last shot. Now, there goes the cupcake.
Couldn't end better, man.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you so much, and all your friends over there. Thank you very much.
Well, I'll see you next week, guys. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye now. That was great, man. That was great. I enjoyed it. I don't know if it was great for you, but I had a good time. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry my sound wasn't right before. I finally got notified. It's okay. It happens. These things happen. On my side, it was, which is even better, because now in the edit, I'll have to edit myself out. You know, any dumb question I ask, I can seem a lot more smarter by not saying a word, because the whole story there was Silverman. Now, you know, we probably don't need to do a clip, a credit clip into the after party, because we've kind of dragged it on. We got 20 minutes left, and I don't want to waste any time with that. We will finish up with our credits, but nice job all around. Guys did a great job. That was so much fun. Thank you, Jay, for even convincing us to do that. And Silverman, fantastic. But people are going to have questions. So why don't we just open the mics and any question can come up and you can answer them. You can do all that stuff. I will just sit by here and I'll listen. I'm going to take a spot.
We are really now like a network TV show. We just did a live remote from Mare Island, California. I want to extend a great thank you to the Golden Gate Stereo Group for being the man on the scene there for us. How can we not have a legendary show when we have Silverman on the show?
Yes, and you'll excuse us for not running an Anaglyph jukebox, apparently, right? So there we go.
There's always next week.
Oh man, there is. And
this show is jam-packed. We ran past 4 o'clock just with the regular show.
I know we had to on this one. Yeah. I generally like to bow a little early, but man, that was great. 1 second. Yeah, sorry about the audio problem, but go ahead.
In the chat, people are asking what were they using to do that broadcast that we were seeing so clearly?
Oh, he was just used. He just
used his phone. Okay.
I'm hearing an echo. Why am I hearing?
Hi.
That's why. Okay. Hi, Stephen.
Hi, I'm here in Chicago. I'm in my studio and I have puppets galore on view.
Well, oh, please.
Let's. I can turn this around. But my belly dancer there.
Oh, there we go.
There we are. And we're screening stuff on 3D monitor. With 3D. Here's my camera demonstrating Puppet Vid 3D. Glad to see you guys. I got to check out.
Oh, man. Thank you for giving us our. Could you tilt the? We love looking at you, but I could you turn the camera over to your puppets again? Man, is that how you store them? Obviously, that's a stupid question because they're being stored.
No, they're all in cases. I don't store them because the light is bad for them.
Ah. And who makes them, Stephen? Who made them?
Well, this one is by Bill Baird, my teacher. Did the puppets for The Sound of Music. Might have heard of him. Mm-hmm. And then these are the gum wrappers. They're mine.
Now you made those? The gum wrappers?
Wow. Yep.
What are they made of? What are they made out of?
They're mostly wood. Mostly wood. And here we have the ghosts for Halloween. They're what we call tandem marionettes. One person works all three of those. And this is another Bill Baird puppet here. Well, it's hard for me because I can't turn around, but that's Boo Boo the Devil.
Hey, say somebody cut his Boo-Boo. Strings. Oh, there we go. Okay, there we go. Hey, will you ever
well,
take me?
Well, well.
Nice job, Steve.
Is the belly dancer puppet seeing anyone? Is she involved? Does she have a relationship? Does she have an email address?
I don't know. I don't know too much about her. She's unusual. She was used at Busch Gardens in Virginia. And she has 10-foot strings. So this is really unusual. That
wow. Why would they be so long?
Very high up to the ceiling. I have 11-foot ceilings here. I wasn't able to actually turn the strings over. I can't do the whole thing.
Is there a reason out, that...
But it's unusual. You don't usually get this view of her. If you get Bill Baird's book, she's in the book, but you don't get wow. to see her backside like that.
I was about to ask you that question. I'm glad you cut to the chase. I'll cut to the butt. Does that seem a little unusual?
For people who don't know, could you just explain a little bit about who Bill Baird is and why he's
Thank
so
you.
Significant?
Thank you, John. Yes, indeed, please.
Yeah, Bill Baird in the history of puppetry in America had a theater on Barrow Street in New York, and I was employed there for a few years. He did have the Chrysler Pavilion at the New York World Fair in 64, 65, and used the money from that and from The Sound of Music to build a theater on Barrow Street. That was there till, I guess, about 1980. And after that, I had my own theater on Union Square for 10 years, from about 1988 to 98. And Bill, he wrote a book called The Art of the Puppet. That's pretty well known. And then all the people from Bill went over to Henson because that's where the work was and the money was. So that was happening while I was there. So the Henson company is definitely just an outgrowth of Bill's company, or many of the people. Of course, Henson brought on many, many more people. But a lot of people went from Baird to Henson.
Could you get a little closer to her face?
Yeah.
Where? So, Stephen, that's wood? That's wood?
The head is not wood. The head is a fiberglass type material called celastic. Which we don't use anymore because it's a toxic process. It's dipped in acetone. Yeah. So we're using other materials now, urethanes and foams and plastics, and rubbers, but not doing celastic so much anymore.
Is that a sandcasted mold? How's that done?
It's plaster. I carve everything in clay, plasticine, and then make a plaster mold. A negative of that, and then we can cast that in other materials like paper mache. Celastic works very similarly to paper mache, except you're dipping into acetone instead of paste.
Acetone, that explains the outfit. But no, that's really really fascinating to me, man.
Really beautiful.
Oh, the feet. Figure. Go down to the feet, please. I gotta see the feet.
Yeah. The feet, these are actually a restoration. The feet were originally rubber and they deteriorated. So these are new feet that we had carved pretty recently, but they're an exact duplicate of the original feet. So she's mostly intact, but her feet didn't make it. They're just replaced within the last couple of years.
Oh, that man.
Was a little project of mine, restoring them.
And the other crew over there are the wrappers, right?
Yeah, gum wrappers. They're mine completely. They wrap the alphabet, among other things, and they're designed to hip hop. Yeah, I'd work them for you, but I can't hold the camera and work the puppets at the same time. We'll have to do some other stuff another time, John.
You are great. Oh, thank you for taking the time, Steve. No, we have to do plenty. I mean,
Yeah,
we got to chat. I would love to have a piece every week on. I'd love to interview one of those guys.
Yeah,
I'm partial to the lady, but that's another story. But I'd like to know. No, really. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you again.
All right. You got to let me go. I have an audience here in my studio.
Thank you for being so generous. I'll see you next week.
All right. Bye bye.
Thank you. Bye now. Now, do we have any? Okay. Oh, you mean the stuff? Yeah. I'm answering. I'm doing just what I did last week, Dorothy. I'm reading the question and answering like everybody knows the question. That mean the material that they're made from. Is that what you're talking about, Jay? Because he brought up a question about the material that the marionettes for the puppet. I don't know what I don't want to insult the puppet by calling it a marionette. God forbid, or a dummy, even worse. God forbid. That was a lot of fun. We got to do more with Steven, right, Joe?
Oh, absolutely. There's something inherently sculptural and 3D when you take the kind of caricature in space. You know what I thought? Johnny Laser, hear me out. I think most of our audience is probably familiar with the caricaturist Al Hirschfeld, the theatrical caricaturist, who in like four or six lines could give you Jerry Lewis. And I was thinking about that, like reducing the face and the form to just really essential shapes. And I think that we saw that in that Bill Bard belly dancer puppet. You know, that face was really just kind of like reduced to the essentials.
Very good, very good. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I couldn't explain it that well, but it was processing, but yeah.
And then I'd love to see that in depth.
Yeah, we got to figure out how to work with Steven. Back to Silverman, do we have any questions? Because I hope I didn't, blunder my way through all the questions, but...
Now, wait a minute. I just want to confirm for our viewing audience, this was just part one, right?
Okay,
we have just begun. Is there part two and part three? Or is it just part two?
Well, at least part two.
Okay.
We have to have the post-rain mud experience.
Yeah.
And then Harold, could we have like a final freeze frame like they used to have on Hollywood apocalyptic movies, where instead of the end it would say the beginning?
The beginning.
Yeah.
Well, there's always another.
Like they say at Burning Man, it was better next year.
Good, man. Oh, you're full of those, aren't you? Yeah, it was better next year. That's great. But so you're only silver from the neck up. You can't be so. I'm sure at this point you didn't bother silvering anything else.
Well, no, these shirts come in handy. You know, you use less makeup that way.
Now, are those shirts custom made for you? Where would one get a shirt like that?
Amazon.
No, but he meant the real Amazon.
Yeah. You have to travel.
Well, you actually have to travel to the South America. Speak Portuguese. That first thing. Oh man. Thank you for that. I'm sorry I came in. You weren't able to hear me. Actually, in many ways, I'm glad you weren't able to hear my questions. But I'm sorry I wasn't more clear. But you were like always spectacular. Those images are great, man. Now, how much do you massage them in Photoshop? Or do you?
You know, people, I think I'm not unusual. I kind of obsess trying to get the best out of a shot, but yeah, I spend way too much time. Not that I manipulate them that much, but you want to get you bring out the detail and mm-hmm. get the colors right and crop it.
Yeah, right. It's
I've been manipulating digital photographs in Photoshop now for decades, and I would say that there's almost no digital photograph I've ever seen that couldn't use at least a levels adjustment.
Yeah, right. Yep. I think Jerry used to say, bring up the saturation. And I agree with that. I do that now too, because there's something about an artificial color that actually is more real. if you leave it the way that, because the camera doesn't see like you see, you know.
Yeah, our memories are more vivid than what we see. That's
excellent. Yeah, that's a good description. So it's always good to, I tend to do that now myself. Usually I shied away from that, but not anymore. You know, we must have nailed it. Me and you, Silverman, because I don't see any questions. Any other questions coming up? Wow. The only question is when you're coming back, but we'll discuss that during the week, because how do we do that? What was that? Tying the woman to the track as the train's coming. That's what exactly. We haven't got to that point yet. So let's leave them with something. Now, so this whole catastrophe unfolded before you and your shutter's eyes, right? And then this is where we're going to leave them. How did you finally get out? What was your last day? Don't get to the actually leaving, but what built up to that final day?
Well, it's kind of interesting. This will be repeated, of course, but normally the man burns on Saturday night. He didn't burn till Monday night. Basically, 2 days were lost where people were just trapped in mud and couldn't do things. And then the temple burned on Tuesday night. Traditionally, I leave on Tuesday morning. So I left on Wednesday morning. So for me, it was only extended 1 day. For most people, Burning Man was extended 2 days because they couldn't leave.
You had figured it out, I guess, from being there enough.
Well, like a lot of people that have gone many years, I stay typically 1 day longer than most people.
To beat the excess. Yeah. Ooh, we're going to get to you, and you know we'll get some of your stuff. That I think that's just fantastic that you guys. So it's wonderful of you. I know you take the images to share them. That's my point. I was trying to get to that. They're not meant for you. They're actually meant for everyone. And what a generous thing to do for all of us.
Well, thank you. I kind of feel a responsibility and a need to keep doing it. You know, after 26 burns, it's sort of a photojournalistic endeavor. You know, and if I... Yeah, I don't want to stop doing it. You know, so I have to. Yeah.
You know, I went through a little bit of that, not as much as you, but in Times Square, because I shot Times Square for at least 10, you know, probably 12 years. And I had the same thing from a historical perspective is why I was going back, because I, you know, after you shoot it, you shoot it. It's just that at the end of it, it started to get, there were too many regulations. So it was like, this ain't any fun anymore. You know, it just wasn't fun. But yeah, I got about 12, but I understand that drive, because who the hell wants to go out on New Year's Eve? Exactly. And find a parking spot and then go to Times Square. Uh-huh. And then get this in, you know, but just for the same reason you go, well, not probably very close. I felt compelled at that point. After we had so many years, like 4 or 5, it's like, I got to keep doing this. I was trying to get up to 2010, which was the anniversary of the first ball drop, but you know, there was a time when you could put a girl on your shoulders in Times Square. They don't allow that. So it's like, all right, I'm done. You know, well, for good reason. I'm not arguing whatever they got to do. They're trying to keep people safe. But they got Johnny Lazer on and Sheldon Arano was too, because we. But yeah, I understand that draw. It's just I had to fight it. Even every year, you know, people say, do you miss it? Yeah, I there's something about that. Because you know what? Everybody in the world who knows you knows where you are at that moment. You're just like with you at Burning Man. Well, again, we're pretty close to the end. And it seems that we've accomplished a lot. So at this point, I want to thank Silverman and the folks at Golden Gate Stereoscopic Society and our NYSA crew for making this all possible. Because Jim Harp, Dorothy Goodman, Jay Kuznets, Joe Padono, and you, and all of you for stopping by to see what you've been missing in 3D. So I think at this point, we're going to run the credits because we got a new way of doing things. We're doing all new stuff here, you know. Of course, that would be the day that everything broke down here. That's one of the reasons. The least problem we had was the sound, man, because this might look like what was left after the rain and the playa, because it's pretty bad here, man. It's going to take me a while to put it back in the hat. But you all know that. wire here, wire there. Next thing you know, it's magic. Thanks again. Well, I'll be chatting with you during the weeks. Thank you, Silverman. Thank you. Well, I have to say, everybody, on everybody's behalf, thank you very much. I am going to run the credits. See you guys next week.